find out ways. We've all, black people have always had to navigate this. Immigrant communities, women have always had to navigate this. We've got to find a way to support one another, elevate one another, but then reinsert our values, the values that come from African peoples, which is of collectivism. That means if we're going to support you, how can you give back, which is what the brothers have said a number of times. If you're going to invest in this black bank, how are you then going to reinvest in our communities?
You know, Umi, that's a good point, because in about 2 days, uh-huh, I'm about to witness the transition of power of somebody who is leading a country that has the largest treasury, uh-huh, on planet Earth. Right. And politics is about two things, right? Those who have the power to make laws, and those who have the power over the money to enforce those laws.
Right.
Right. And Umi's point is that what we got to teach people more about is how they get access to,
uh-huh,
the ability to,
uh-huh,
having an impact on the budget,
uh-huh,
and making the laws,
mm-hmm,
right? So the most important thing is not the amount of money in your pocket, per se.
Uh-huh.
It's also about what you do with your individual power to change laws,
yep,
and to change budgets,
yep,
right? So in my opinion, a vote is more powerful than the bills in your pocket.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
You can be wealthy and not doing anything with your personal power.
Right. I would have to second that.
You know, so mm-hmm, even though there's some truth to the economic power that oppresses,
uh-huh,
many people of, uh-huh, color, brown and black folks, political power can also help you to achieve wealth.
Right.
More than wealth helping you to achieve political power.
Right. Right, which is right. That's what's up.
If I could also add, I heard someone say this at the 5,000 Role Models breakfast.
How was that?
It was good.
How do you get invited to something like that?
Walk up in there.
Really?
No, it's thousands of people, tons of open seats.
Buy your ticket like everyone else.
To see the guys be awarded is amazing. My only message, and I'll probably write a letter, is that I don't like hearing the message of we're awarding them to keep them out of jail.
Yeah,
no, we're awarding them and giving them a scholarship so they can have a bright future and attain wealth and, you know, build for their family. If we always keep jail in the forefront of their minds, what the stories you tell become like you live, our CEO says. And if you always keep telling stories of jail, that's where people are going to end up, whether they intentionally went there or not.
Right.
Paul says, when I tried not to sin, is when I sin, because I'm focused on the sin.
Right.
But the person said that every, you know, white person is not your enemy and every black person is not your friend.
Right.
And we need, mm-hmm, to take our own personal stake and responsibility in building our own communities. The same guy I was talking about from New York Life, he's in Liberty City cleaning up a cemetery with mostly white folks.
Right.
I mean, building a community, cleaning a cemetery, getting dirty, the weeds are like feet high, while across the street there's dancing and a barbecue and a party going on.
Right.
On MLK Day, the folks living in that community weren't cleaning it up. And here you have people who are coming from outside the community who are not even black cleaning this community. The shootings that happen, some of the conditions of our community, has nothing to do with Donald Trump. In six cities, there were shootings on Martin Luther King Day. Nothing to do with Donald Trump. We need to take personal responsibility in building up our own communities, taking pride in our own communities, and making other people respect our communities.
Well, with that being said, I want to jump back to Umi, because that's one of the things, like, I hear a lot of people talk, and I hear a lot of, I enjoy a lot of pro-black rhetoric and all that kind of stuff. You know, but it was something why I connected with this brother that he said that took it a step further. It's not about just, you know, stopping the traffic on the highway. It's not about just sitting, you know, and in front of the courthouses and doing all these things. It's also about going into the community and inspiring the community and having the community police itself. And that was one of your, you know,
yeah,
one of your things. Could you just, because he just spoke about that, could you just talk about that real quick?
Well, yeah, I mean, first off, these are the brothers that are doing it, so it's great to be here with them. I don't think I'm gonna say anything that they don't know, but for folks listening in, our community, one of the biggest proclamations people made from the movement. We hear a civil rights movement, we hear voting rights, we hear integration, but one of the biggest things that people talked about was self-determination, right? Self-determination, the ability of Black people, which we were calling ourselves a colony at that time, which in a lot of ways we were. It sounded extreme.
Mm-hmm.
But the ability for Black people to decide their todays and their tomorrows, right? Other people in this country, predominantly wealthy white people, definitely not all white people.
Mm-hmm.
The great majority of white people don't have this privilege, just like we don't. But the ability to decide, make decisions for themselves. How will our kids be educated? What will they read? How will I find shelter? What type of food do I put in my body? What do elected officials do when they go to meetings? A lot of communities, you know, you can go to El Portal, they have some self-determination, right? They understand when the trash is going to be picked up. They understand what you're going to build and who's going to build it. They have true self-determination.
Right.
When you're talking about what is this new conception of a movement, it's being in the community like all of us are doing, right? It's political education, it's a radical change in values, and it's really talking about what does self-determination look like? What is the ability, if we had the opportunity to not, and I wouldn't even use the word police, right? I would say to provide for the safety of our communities in a different way that didn't involve police, that also didn't involve us surveilling on people. Nobody likes when even the grandma, you know, your business, watching what you're doing,
right.
Where you're going, what you're doing. We're not talking about that, but how can the community come together and decide what safety looks like and how do we engage with violence? It's not utopian. We know violence is going to happen. Guns going to get shot. People going to do what people have been doing, frankly, for 400 years in this country. And if you want to learn where people got this, you can just look at the history of the United States. The history of the United States is rooted in violence. And when guns came about, we was one of the first people at the counter.
Mm.
And so, yeah.
My question is, so why doesn't it occur in all communities?
What?
The gun violence.
Well, one, violence, period, is a symptom of poverty. And when you're in extreme poverty conditions, violence is going to happen. The gun proliferation, guns are pumped into our community. You can't get guns as easy. You don't need to go to, you can't go to Bell Harbor and just walk up to somebody and ask about a gun. But you could definitely go to Inglewood in Chicago and find a place. Our access to guns is easier than any community that you'll look around and find. And that's intentional in my belief and my understanding. It wasn't always like that. And what I'll also say, I'm going to just say a thing, and it might sound controversial. There was a time in the 40s, 50s, and 60s and before where every Black household had a gun. Every single Black household had a gun, urban or rural, because it was a central part of our tapestry, how we ate and how we defended ourselves against the KKK. But what came with that gun was education about it. I went shooting with my line brother, who's in the military, over Christmas break in New Orleans. And look, this brother wouldn't even let me pick up the 9mm until he talked to me for like 30 minutes about it. 30 minutes, I'm like, bro, I know. No, take your finger. The level of education that comes with a gun, I'm actually not for taking away guns from everybody. But the education that comes along with that is not there. It's just not there.
So where does the responsibility of the gun owner or the one that's shooting it comes up?
I mean, that's us.
Yeah. We're not helpless. We're not. Umi's point is that we are not helpless.
Right.
There is no issue or problem or challenge within any community of color that is spoken about by other people in power, including the president-elect, or infestation or any challenge that can't be solved by us. None. Someone tell me. Self-determination is all about that. And we have to change our own culture, house by house, block by block, mm-hmm. school by school, We don't have to wait any media to write any stories. The reason why to me, is changing the game, right? We are self-determining what stories we want to share.
Right.
We're not going to listen to none of your stats or...
Unapologetic.
Mm-hmm. Right? We're not going to qualify it. We're not going to repackage it. We're going to tell it authentically, mm-hmm. right? Why we do what we do, right? And if I can magnify Marlon Hill by 10, just Marlon Hill,
right.
I can self-determine what the impact is going to be.
I can appreciate the start of the Black Panther movie and what their purpose was and what they did for the community. They didn't wait for nobody to come in to save the day.
Or when Marcus Garvey is pardoned tomorrow.
Yeah. Like, we have it. It's there. The knowledge is there.
Let's see.
The knowledge is there. But who's willing to partake?
Right. I'm really interested in your perspective on it, because the way I see it is not a one way, right? It's definitely not. And I think we're people that we're kind of in such dire straits that we're not in an or proposition. We're in an and proposition at all times. Mm-hmm. What works? But I'm really interested in your position. I know we've got to gun somehow, but on that subject.
Well, just to interject real quick, I think I'm going to be getting involved with this initiative that they're having in Miami, Together for Children.
Yeah, I'm involved in that too.
You're involved in that? All right, so I'll see you at the meeting on Thursday.
We already been to the meetings.
There's another meeting.
There's one up north.
There's one in one down south. Right. There's one at Northwestern
tomorrow.
That I'll be going to tomorrow. Because I actually, just to let you know, I actually reached out and said, hey, I talk to your kids all the time. They listen to me all the time. My ratings show that my higher listenership is actually 12-year-olds to 34-year-olds. You know, even more than the station across the street, that age group. What can I do? How can I get involved? And she just came right in and said, this is our initiative. This is what we're going into. This is what's up. Because of your anger with the gun violence and stuff like that, what do you think about the Together for Children?
I think it's a great thing. We're getting involved on the behavioral health aspect. We're trying to change the mindset and the behaviors. Why do I feel that I have to act this way? Or what makes me? What is the trigger? What is the trigger that makes me want to go and shoot someone? So we have clinical psychologists and mm-hmm. Social workers that we're employing
right.
at my organization, so we could go to the community and try to get an understanding of the triggers and then help them reshape whatever that trigger is so they could get a better outcome.
Well, we can help them along, Jonathan, because you know budgets reflect priorities.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so the Mayor Jimenez said uh-huh. today at the State of the County Address
uh-huh.
that youth violence is one of his number one priorities, that anything that happens in that community impacts all of us. Right?
Yeah, when they gave it with the Children's Trust $10 million here's my issue, though. I don't want to say issue. Here's my concern, is that again, it's like with these type of things. It's like, I'll give an example. It's like a group of men sitting in a boardroom talking about what's good for women's health or what's a proper, you know, like. I don't feel like the group that are organizing a lot of these things around the table are hip enough. And I don't believe they allow certain people in that they need to allow in to kind of shake things up and give more of a...
They had several meetings with the community people. They sent... I was there. And we had several meetings where we had to give our input.
What do you consider community people?
People that's actually on the ground doing work in the community, doing the work inside
the same people that a lot of these kids are already ignoring?
I wouldn't know because, you
know. No, but I'm just saying, you know, and I'm not saying it in a disrespectful way. I'm just saying, like, yo, those are the same community people that's been around for the last 10 years or whatever the case may be. And if you're still having the same problems, you got to switch how you're doing it. You can't do the same thing and expect anything to really change that much. You know what I mean? And I feel that they're missing out on a big, I feel they're missing out on a big situation. You understand?
Well, if you put the call out for stories and you put the call out for people to come to the meetings and you invite people, just like you said, you found out about it and you called them, and they said, come on.
Yeah, but here's my thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. But suppose I did it. I have a platform of 10 million people a week with this radio show. I just finished telling you my number one audience is 12-year-olds to 34-year-olds. So at what point now do you say, nah, we need this? How do we get you to understand what we're trying to do and we can work together? And that, what I think, is the missing link. And I'm not one, Molly could tell you, I'm not one for people to come and kiss my ass here. But I knew nothing better. And I woke up. And now I'm taking it on myself to do all these different things that's going on. But suppose I never woke up. I could just be in this position here for the next 5 years and nobody would have the gall to come up and be like, yo, dude, you're sitting on a platform that we need. What's up? What you doing? What are we doing?
So I'm glad that you took it upon yourself to reach out.
So my point is that now that I know that, I need to run a task force of people like me who don't know, who don't care, who are not connected, exactly, to be involved in those meetings.
True.
So that we can shake some things up on a real level.
And I'm glad we said it on Facebook Live so the listeners can even chime in. Right. Seriously.
That's what's up, man. And yeah, thank everybody on Facebook Live. We are here. It's called A Stage on Wednesday, where we share a platform for things people are doing that are pretty amazing in the community. Again, I just want to, the gentleman that I have up in here, just to say their name, give their social media so people could connect with you on another level. You know what I'm saying? Mr. Jonathan Spikes.
Jonathan Spikes. Facebook, Jonathan Spikes. Twitter, Jonathan Spikes. Instagram, Jonathan Spikes.
And how do they get involved now with what you're doing in terms of the play and stuff like that? How can they connect with you on that level?
AffirmingYouth.com.
There you go. All right. Attorney Marlon Hill, Esquire.
Yes, just Google me, man. Marlon Hill. There's another Marlon Hill. if there's another Marlon Hill, he plays chess. He's a chess champion. Yeah, but we're working on this law academy at Brownsville and Middle School in Brownsville. So if you want to support our impact fund with the Be Me, you can send a donation to the Miami Foundation and help us magnify this law academy at Brownsville Middle School. Just the HMB Brownsville Middle School Law Academy is opening up on August 2017.
Congratulations, brother. Big Ben, what up? Brother Ben.
Me too. Not a lot.
No, just kidding. But catch me on Instagram and Twitter at iBenEvans. Catch me on Facebook at Brother Ben, BROTHABN. That was my radio name back in the day at FAMU.
All right.
You can also get information about this grant, $10,000, 5 questions, Black Genius Award, BMEcommunity.org is BMEcommunity.org. We're having an event at Venture Cafe on January 26th, which is next Thursday. Yeah. We're going to be talking about this. You're going to meet these guys. We're going to answer your questions. But we're also going to talk about how do we continue building our communities under this new administration.
Nothing's
changed. No days off. We need to keep building. Keep our focus on. Let's talk about how we're going to do that right here in Miami. Venture Cafe. Look it up. January 26th.
All right, Umi.
Umi Selah, Dream Defenders at Umi Selah, UMISELAH on all social media, at Dream Defenders on all social media. We have an event this evening at 7:00 p.m. at Turnaround Beauty and Barber Salon. We're going to be learning about the prison system and the schools. And please, please, whatever you do, do not Google me.
Listen to the images.
Coming up next, we got K-Fox, 10 joints in a row, commercial free. It's going down. Make sure you jump on that Facebook at 103.5 The Beat to check out the whole interview, man. A lot of good stuff there for you guys, all right? Awesomeness. To the extreme. This was one of the best.
Yes. Uh-huh.
One of the best. This is like the vision that I had for the stage as we roll out the name today. And this is exactly what I wanted. You know what I mean? Everybody had some great perspectives. We talked about some things. There was some light debate on some other things and support. And thank you so much. And please continue to, you know, invite others and teach others about what we're trying to do here. Like I said, Umi's with me with this. You know, he's been a great help to me. He's a very fair but strong and conscious brother. And Ben, you know, I feel the same about you. And you know, I want to kind of invite you up to you know, mix it up with us every once in a while as well, because you have a lot to offer, a lot of the stats to offer us as well.
All about the facts.
Esquire, you're done though. Just facts. Bring them calm, anything you got going on. And it's a pleasure. I know your face, but it's a pleasure to officially meet you. just to kind of circle back, I guess we could call this the after stage, behind the stage or whatever, real quick, in all respect to K-Fox, who has to come in here next. That's what the problem was for me. You understand what I'm saying? It's like I was not in the know, but here I'm sitting on a level of power and influence. So I felt abandoned. And there's a lot of people out there just like that, that just feel like they don't belong to nothing, they don't know enough, mm-hmm. and they don't feel like anybody's kind of reaching out to them because they're not a part of the clique. Mm. You understand what I'm saying?
Pastor Jackson, right across the street. He did a sermon on that.
Uh-huh.
You know, some people sit in the church and say, ain't nobody asked them to do anything.
Uh-huh.
But when they found out about it, they complained about it.
Right.
And I'm glad you didn't complain. You took action because somebody, everybody can't know everybody. Even if we do know that you do this, that you probably should have reached out, but they didn't. I'm glad you took it upon yourself to reach out to them.
But now, with that being said, and now that we know this, and now you know this, and I know this, mm-hmm. what can I or we do to inspire not everybody, but the powerful ones that don't get it? You understand what I'm saying? People who are in these like positions where they have media, where they have a certain level of reach, mm-hmm. to inspire them to kind of understand how they're needed, and then mm-hmm. you know, bring them in, and then send them back out to reach the masses. You know what movie inspires me every time I watch it? 300. Like every time I watch it, I learn something new. That movie 300, mm-hmm. as simple as you see it, you know what I mean? So it's like if we can have that 300 of really powerful individuals, because I'm going to tell you, I felt blanked by so many different situations. 100 Black, man, you name them. I just felt like I was never a part of anything or never belonged to mm-hmm. anything, or and I'm just keeping it real. Why? Because I'm hip-hop? Why? Because I'm not a part of a clique? I don't know, and I'm not expecting you to give me the answer, but I'm just telling you.
If we sit around and think someone, or feel that someone should ask us, then something, half of the stuff will never get done.
Yeah, but again, you lose your focus on the power of connecting to an audience that you need.
That may be true.
Okay, then. So what are we going to do? Just act like we don't see that?
No, but even with BME, trying to get someone to apply for a $10,000 grant that we're going to give you the money for your organization.
Uh-huh.
Got to keep pumping them up. Everybody ain't gonna ask you. Sometimes you have to go out and get it.
I know, but I still think you're missing the point I'm trying to make.
I understand what you said. There is power in asking you to be a part of it.
Yes,
so why aren't there? Right. Why aren't so, they tapping right into that power?
Right. I get that people part. I get it. Don't know that they can.
Here's
and after, somebody on here said we need to stop asking for permission.
Exactly.
To right.
Do. Here's the after stage lesson.
Right.
We're not going to wait anymore.
Thank you.
To write the narrative of what needs to change. Right. So. Whether it's Urban Entrepreneur, whether it's Be Me, whether it's any of the groups that we know, right? We just need to connect the dots among each other. Sharing, Umi has access to certain information. You have access to a certain world. Jonathan has access to a certain world. What the Be Me, as an example, is done is cross-pollinating our worlds.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So we just need to kind of improve our communication.
Yes.
Right? So that when you see an issue, you call up Jonathan and say, Jonathan, you heard about this. Together for Children, what's up with that money?
Right.
Who's managing the budget? Because they have to advertise.
Right.
They have to communicate. They have to send press releases. Is their press list updated?
Right.
Right? Or are they sending out information to the right people? We can't wait for them because they're making decisions on the 29th floor and City Hall without us.
Never even think about us.
Right.
Only from a consumer perspective because we spend our money with them. But other than that.
Right.
Yeah. So.
But that whole dynamic has
right.
That whole
it has to, man. Yeah. It really has to, Esquire. I ain't lying to tell you. It has to. And I'm only coming from a perspective, and I'm saying this to you guys, because I need that to be spread. Because I'm telling you, it's just, it could be me, but I know there's more like me. And I'm going to do my part now. And I have been doing my part. I have been reaching out to others and people and trying to inspire others who do what I do. And I want it to spread. But it's important. Because we have a lot of people that are in positions to mold our children. And that's the key word. I ain't studying the adults. And I ain't studying all that stuff. Our children. Anybody that could effectively influence and encourage our children, we have to deal with that with a certain level
of
importance or respect or whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. So I, because I realize it now, I am now starting to reach out like this. Like, you come that does what I do. You come that does what I do or has the, a level of reach that I do. Come, let me show you what's going on here. But because, again, I'm so, like, learning and I'm so new to a lot of things, I'm pulling all you guys in to kind of, like, really help me to understand how to better spread that message and to give more support in the movement.
That doesn't discount what you're an expert at.
Okay. Correct. Okay. Correct. So
you have your, you know, you have your standards of what you're good at. Ben has his knowledge base. Jonathan has his knowledge base. But when you put us on a feed sharing information, you just gotta watch out because it's just about, you know, collective. Umi has his intelligence. Mm-hmm. I have my intelligence, right? Because of the different things that I'm involved in. As long as we keep it circulated.
That's without true. Asking for their permission. We're
without,
doing it.
Without, well, that's or, what I'm or, doing. No problem. That's what I'm doing.
Heard.
I forgot to share.
Gentlemen, we're going to wrap up the
information about
sorry,
one of our guys is taking, they're taking kids to Africa this summer.
Oh, that's so awesome.
I will shoot you the information.
Yeah.
Out to network.
Yeah.
Kids were making the grades. Mm-hmm. They're taking them to Africa, a part of the leadership program called the NEA Project.
Mm-hmm.
And two of our guys are working on it, and three are participating. And I think I might go over there.
Oh, that's dope, man. Well, connect me with that.
So
yeah.
I forgot to mention it.
All right. Can blast that one. Yeah, just connect me with that information, man. Yeah. That's something we'd definitely like to.
Yeah. Oh, word. Yeah. I'm